In order to measure and find out the time, nowadays we have watches, be it wall clocks or wrist watches. But in ancient times, what did people use? Because watches were obviously not there. One of the earliest examples of an instrument to measure time is that of a sundial. Now, a sundial, as you can see, consists of a raised structure. Now, based on the movement of the sun in the duration of a day and the position of the shadow of this structure, people used to say what time of the day it is. So let's say at noon, the sun is directly overhead, as we know. So when the sun is directly overhead, there will be no shadow or a very, very tiny shadow of this entire structure. So in this way, a sundial was used along with its shadow to find out what time of day it is. There were many other instruments that were used for measuring and calculating time. One of the instruments used was a candle clock. Now, a candle clock, as you can see, was constructed of a fixed length and it had certain markings on its size. So in this manner, people in ancient China, where candle clocks were most popular, said what time of the day it is. In a similar manner, mostly in ancient Greece, the concept of hourglasses were used. Now in hourglass, as you can see, there is sand inside. So when the hourglass is in this position, sand pours from the top compartment to the bottom compartment. And when this sand has fallen from this compartment, this hourglass used to be reversed, and then sand started flowing from this compartment to this compartment. Over the course of time, hourglasses in general became a symbol for the concept of time. Mechanical clocks, like the one you can see in the picture, were developed much, much later on, most probably in the time during Renaissance. Now let me tell you about the evolution of pendulum and their regulations with respect to a clock. Now, as early as the 16th century, sometime in the 1580s, Galileo Galilei, the Italian polymath, found out that with the help of a pendulum, it was possible to measure a given time duration. Now, he postulated that if a pendulum is used, it can be used to regulate the movement of a clock. Now, at that point of time, at 1580, Galileo did not actually go into the design of the clock. Further miniaturizations and much more developments took place, and sometime in the late 1680s, a Dutch astronomer known as Christian Huygens came up with the first development of a pendulum clock, that is, regulation of the clock with the help of a pendulum. So let us see how this regulation was done. Over here, we have considered a pendulum. Now you will notice that the pendulum is suspended from a fixed support with the help of a string. And at the other end of the string, there is a metallic bob. Now we are releasing the pendulum from one end. It is swinging to the other end and coming back. Now this entire process is taking some amount of time. And as you can see, the motion of the pendulum is repetitive. How can we definitely say it's repetitive? Consider the pendulum being released from the right. After swinging to the other end, it comes back to the right. Similarly, if you consider releasing the pendulum from the left, you will notice that after swinging, it comes back to the left. Similarly, let us say we make the pendulum start from the central position. You will find that after swinging, it comes back to its central position. So as we can clearly see, the motion of a pendulum is repetitive. And this motion from one end back to the other end and back to where it started from is known as one full cycle. So how do we define one full cycle? One complete to and fro motion of the pendulum from the mean position and back is known as one oscillation or one full cycle. So this gave us, in those early times, the concept of time and how it can be regulated with the help of a pendulum. It can be regulated if we consider the time period for a pendulum. Now, time period is nothing but time taken by an oscillating body to complete one cycle of oscillation. So let's say we have a pendulum which has a time period of 1 second. It would imply that it is completing one cycle in 1 second. Now, time period is usually denoted by T and the SI unit is seconds. So if we have a pendulum having a time period of 1 second, it meant that it completed one oscillation or one full cycle in 1 second. And using this concept, it was possible in those times to regulate the movement of a clock. Now, the time period of a pendulum depends on two things. Firstly, it is directly proportional to the length of the pendulum, or in other words, the length of the string that we have considered. And secondly, it is dependent on the acceleration due to gravity. So as you can see, time period T is directly proportional to root over L, that is the length, and time period T is directly proportional to root over 1 by G, or in other words, it is inversely proportional to the square root of G, that is the acceleration due to gravity. So if we introduce an equality sign in place of the proportionality, we find that time period is equal to 2 into pi into root over L by G, where L is the length of the pendulum and G is the acceleration due to gravity. So if we go above the earth at a certain point where G changes, then for a given length, time period would be decided by the acceleration due to gravity. Whereas if we are on the surface of the earth and we consider different lengths of the string of the pendulum, then the time period would be defined by the length of the pendulum. And this is how it was possible to regulate time with the help of a pendulum.